this Sodom, Sodom in that land, when those angels came in Genesis chapter 19, you see that it's clearly written in verse 4 that every man, now I cannot believe this aspect saying that all the men were born as gays there. This is not exaggeration, let me tell you, this is not once that's been mentioned, it's twice that's been mentioned. In same chapter 19, verse 11, it comes to a point wherein the angels blinded them. And verse 11 says that then they blinded all the men, young and old, who were at the door of the house. And so they gave up trying to get inside. Now what was happening there is that they are calling out for these two new men who came to the city to have sexual relationship with them. It gets to a point wherein they are getting wild. And in verse 5, 6, when you read, Lot is trying to plead with those men outside his house door. He's saying, you know what? These are my guests. You can't do something like this to them. And they said, you man, just move away. You are a stranger to this place. Just move away from this place. And he gets to the point where he says, you know what? I'm ready to give my virgin daughters to you. I'm giving my virgin daughters to you. I'll just give it to you. You just do whatever you want. You want to rape them, you do whatever. But just don't touch these guests of mine. They're saying like, get away with your daughter. Get away with yourself. We want those men. We want those men. And explicitly it's saying all the men. I can't believe for this fact that all the men were born like this. Now you can't claim any kind of your desire or sexual lust that you have or any kind of these wicked thoughts that is coming into us and say that we were born that way. If that's the case, people can go around and murder and say that I am born that way. Some people say that I am psyche, I am born that way. You can't just go and say every time that I am born that way. I was trying to write a paper on this and I was studying, you know, some people say that, you know, what, that's exactly what the Indian government also said when the Supreme Court was trying to fight this case about gay, lesbianism and adultery. The Supreme Court says it's not the government's business, it's not the court's business to see what is happening in their rooms, which is very much right, okay, which what they have said is right. But there is a reason why this became illegal. We're going to get to that. Before that, when they said this kind of a statement, what they meant is that I'm not going to put my head into what is happening inside your, behind your doors. Well, then there is this set of people who say that, you know, how is it wrong? What makes, I'm not hurting anybody. I'm having it with mutual consent. What if you have mutual consent? If two people agree together and say that I'm going to rob a bank, is that okay? Now you might say that, okay, robbing a bank basically is taking somebody else's money. It's a mutual consent. What if some two people have mutual consent and say that I'm going to commit suicide? Will you allow that? Why wouldn't you allow that? Why wouldn't suicide be accepted? It's mutual. I'm not hurting anybody. I'm not coming to a point where I'm hurting anybody or anybody's body I'm hurting. I'm not taking anybody's money. Mutual consent. I just try to go and die on my own. Suicide? No, you can't claim this whole thing saying that I'm born this way. So, okay, fine. From now on, whatever I do, it's fine. I'm born this way. No, my dear brothers and sisters, you're listening. You know, these things are coming because we have left God. Now, I've met with these kind of people, plenty of them. They start to think that they are quite wise in their own understanding. They start to think that they are wise in what they think. They think that whatever they are talking is a matter of pride. And you are too narrow-minded not to understand these things. Narrow-mindedness? They call about narrow-minded. Every person who cannot understand this whole aspect of gay and lesbianism, I call it narrow-minded. You and I call it as sin, pure sin. A pure point wherein people have left God and they have fallen from the glory of God, and that's the reason they are selling their bodies. Now, atheist who is listening to me, another person who is listening to me who believes that is fine, would definitely come to this conclusion saying, it is okay, you are narrow-minded. You know, I'm not narrow-minded. Let me tell you, narrow-mindedness is not being open to everything that is coming into you. Now, I would rather say that the ones who are thinking that way are narrow-minded. I'm not just giving blame game statements here. What I'm trying to say, the reason I'm saying that the other set of people are narrow-minded, because their mind is not getting to this point wherein they are realizing that they have just limited their entire thought and their entire body into sexual desires. That's it. I feel like doing something, I do it. And you call that broad-mindedness? I feel like going and sleeping with this man, I go sleep. I feel like going and sleeping with this woman, I go sleep. And you say that's broad-mindedness? No, that's narrow-mindedness. That's basically a point wherein your mind is saying something and just following that. Just following that. Our minds have come to a conclusion wherein we are saying, okay, those kind of wicked things are okay. That's completely okay. Being perverse is completely fine. That's what it says. Verse 27, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserve. And they have come to a point wherein they have done shameful things with each other and they have become pervert. Verse 21 says, they become pervert. It has come to a point wherein these days, if you call some guy or a girl pervert, you know, it's a matter of pride. I feel good. I feel cool when somebody says, you are a pervert. I feel cool. People started to feel cool because they are perverts. They are wicked. The kind of statements that these come, I keep telling them to my church youngsters. The kind of statements that are coming these days, the punchlines that you see as stickers behind the cars and all that. The hell was full, so I am back. My life, my rules. Who are you to ask? All these things that are coming in, who is somebody to lay rules into my life? Who is somebody to tell me what is right and what is not? Now you are actually missing the purpose. As I said, an example a couple of days back, what the example that I gave is basically about this washing machine and this mixer grinder. The purpose of washing machine is different from what that is of a mixer grinder. Now, if you don't understand what is the purpose of the washing machine, you will start to put in vegetables and coconuts inside the washing machine because it's also spinning. It also has got something that is spinning just like the mixer grinder has. Now, the purpose is totally defeated. Now, you and I are born with a purpose. Now, we got to understand what the purpose is. Now, if we don't understand the purpose, if we would end up mixing up our life with something that is not right. Totally mixing our life with something that is not right. Now what is happening? What God wants us to realize is why were you and I born? Why were you and I born? Now, I'm just thinking a little more deeper. I tell this to sometimes when I take some area meetings, I just tell this. I don't know how clearly I can explain this out to you. Now my father has 5 brothers and 1 sister. Basically, my grandfather has 6 children, right? Those 6 children have many other children. So if I count it, somewhere around 14 to 15 children they have. And their children have many more children. I don't know how many are there. I'm losing the count. But you know what? From one person, my grandfather, there is close to around 30 people who have come into this world from my grandfather. I'm just taking the father's perspective. I don't think that I am not taking the mother's perspective, but I'm just taking the father's perspective. Now, from that one person, there are close to 30 people who have come to this world in a span of close to 100 years. Just a span of 100 years, not even 100 years, a span of close to 70 years, there are so many of people who have come to this world. Now, what is happening is basically my grandfather would have taught something to my father. Not necessarily everything that my grandfather told my father would have told me. Now, it's not necessary that what my father has told me, I would have been telling it to my children. I would be telling it to my children. Now, as the days are going by, the information is going less. Now, when God, that's the reason it came to a position where people are saying there is no God. Now, the understanding of God is gone. Now, when Adam and Eve lived with God, they stayed with God in the Garden of Eden. When they were kicked out because of their sin, they were sent out from the Garden of Eden. One thing, when their children came into existence, they would have definitely told their children, you know what, children, I lived, we lived, you and your father and your mother, we lived with God. We stayed with God. We were speaking to God. Now we sinned. This is what we did. And that's the reason we fell from there. They would have taught that to their children. The children came with that understanding. And the children would have told their children, saying, you know what, your father, that's basically my father, they were saying that your grandfather was like this, they lived with God. And that's the information that kept on passing down. But as the generation moved by, I'm pretty sure that the grandchildren would have not told their children about God. Your great-great-grandfather was with God. No, they would have not told that, because that story is meaning nothing much to them. As generations passed by, this understanding of God just left, because God is not coming into the picture. Now, God is not coming into the picture. What you're seeing in the world is what is coming into picture. Now, that's the reason that the information as is not coming down to the people. What basically took place there is that people started to believe that there is no God. All these things came into existence on its own. The information is not passed on quite well. Now, just because we don't understand or we don't see God, it doesn't mean that there is no God. That's the reason Romans chapter 1 verse 23-24, it says this thing that there is no excuse for them to say that there is no God, because they can just see outside and see that there is God. Now, when we leave this God, when we live this God, leave this God, and we cling on to our fleshly, worldly pleasures, what we start to have is that we start to sell our bodies, and we allow our body to be controlled by the sinful desire. Now, let's turn back, let's come down. We just discussed about the sin that is that came into this world with regard to lust, the lustful desires, where men burned with lust for other men, and women burned with lust for other women. They left the natural way of having sexual relations for unnatural way. Not just for men and women, they started to have that even with animals. They started to become as pervert as possible. And when we come down to verse 28, it says, since they thought it is foolish to acknowledge God, he again, this is the third time it's been mentioned, he abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things they should have never done before. Now, God left their hands. I said this before. If God leaves us, we are doomed. Right? We are doomed. When God left them completely, God left them to a point wherein they started to plan up and think things that are foolish. And God said, go ahead and do what your foolish things. And it says that they started to do things they should have never done before. Never done before. Indulging in sex with animals, never done before, never had a thought. Not just that. Now the list starts from verse 29. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate. I wish I could explain each of them. You know, most of the things that are coming into our lives are because of our wickedness and our sin. All these things fall into the aspect of sin. It says that greed, hate, greed. Paul is very explicitly saying to Timothy, you know, the love of money is the root cause of all evil. The love that we have for money is the root cause of all evil. Every evil starts with our greed. More money. Now, just because you have greed is where the next thing, hate, comes in. You will not be able to love people. I'm more greedy, I cannot love somebody. I'm greedy, that's the reason I'm envious. I'm greedy, that's the reason people are ready to murder. I'm greedy, I need more money. For money, people are ready to murder. I'm greedy, that's the reason there is quarreling that is happening. I'm greedy, that's the reason there is deception that is happening. I'm greedy, that's why my behavior is just changing around. I have all the wrong kinds of behavior. And I'm ready to gossip and talk, ready to talk backbite, and ready to talk about others and put them down because I'm greedy. All starts with the love of money. As Paul said, he's not wrong when he says that love of money is the root cause of all evil. He was not wrong. That's very true. The love of money is the root cause of all evil. Make sure that our desire never, it's just a very thin line, wherein we fall into greed and we don't fall into greed. It's a very thin line. We don't even realize when we have fallen into that line. Zach Penn, when he was talking, he was saying this, when we are in this walk with God, we are in a long journey. This is a very long journey. It's like a parallel road that is going. But it's a road that is going towards a destination. Now, when we are, it's not a parallel road, it's a single road. Now, when we are going in that road, when there is a small deviation, even a 1 degree deviation from that. Now, when you go, keep going, this path is going, the deviation takes you to another extent wherein towards the end, you would not be even able to see where your destination was. You will not be able to see where you started, definitely, but you will not be able to see where we are supposed to end. Your destination is somewhere else. Just a 1 degree in the initial stages, you won't even get to know where you have moved away from. But you know, the movement will take you to another extent, and the destination is somewhere else. And you start there and wonder, where am I? The reason that we fall into all these kind of temptation is because we have love for money. And God wants us to be sure that we don't lack anything. You know, that's why Jesus said, you know, you don't worry about your food, don't worry about your clothing, don't worry what you're going to eat or drink. And these are things Jesus was saying in Matthew chapter 6. He's saying these are things that the pagans are thinking about. The normal people, pagans have to think about, because they don't have a heavenly father who's running behind this, who's doing it for them. Pagans have to think for that. That's why he says, don't be like those pagans who think and run behind all these things. You have a heavenly Father who's your provider. If he can take care of the lily that comes in the morning, the grass that comes in the morning and withers away in the night, in the evening, when the sun comes, it's just gone. If he is ready to take care of that, Solomon in all his splendor would not look better than the lily. That's how beautifully he has created. And he says that don't worry. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added. Don't worry about these things. They will come to you. Then you don't have to worry. But what God ideally wants us to do is something that is the reason with which he created and sent us to this world. Now, our purpose with which he sent us to this world, we got to realize that. And for that, we need to read the owner's manual. We need to read the owner's manual. This is the owner's manual that is given into our hands. Read this. The Lord will speak to us and say what it is and where we got to stand. And when we start to realize that, you know, let me tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, you would not lack anything. You got to come to that realization. And we're going to go further. We're going to go further. When we're going further, I want to try to explain to you each of those sins. I'll try my best to explain. But one thing, make sure that in our greed, in our desire for money, let us not store up much more evil in our lives.
You know my heart's, my deeds, I'm calling out, light the fire again. I need your discipline, I'm calling. Make it a poor wretched.